are very few talks and entrepreneurs who have touched me as much as Scott Harrison, who is coming, because he's genuinely changing the world. And I keep thinking about what he does pretty much all the time. It's so inspiring. It will make what you do today questionable. Scott?
I think I'm supposed to stand over here. How is everybody? It's good to be back in Paris. The last time I was here, I was incredibly sick. I'd come from the Central African Republic, where I'd eaten caterpillars in the jungle, and it didn't agree with me. So I spent my whole time in Paris in a hotel room, and it's much, much nicer to... the weather was beautiful, too, so it was killing me to be indoors. I'm so excited to get to share my story with you. Over the next, I guess, about 40 minutes, I'm going to take you through a little bit of how I got into charity water. I'm going to talk about the water crisis, and I'm going to talk about charity water and what we've done over the last 6 years. And it's a lot of photos, and I hate being bored, so I promise I will try not to bore any of you guys. So a little bit about me. This was me as a kid. I was kind of the perfect kid. My parents cut my hair with a bowl, an actual bowl. And when I was about this age, when I was 4 years old, a tragedy happened in my family, and my mom became very, very ill. There was a carbon monoxide gas leak in our house, and she was poisoned by the carbon monoxide. And she became an invalid almost immediately. And for my whole childhood, I grew up, you know, watching my mom, who was amazingly healthy and was a journalist, become just a shell of what she used to be. And I took care of her. I did all the right things. I said all the right things. My parents were conservative Christians, so I grew up in the church and played by the rules. And then at 18 years old, I decided, like so many bad cliches, that I would do something very different. I would rebel. And all of the rules, all the things I wasn't allowed to do, I was going to now do. So I grew my hair down to my shoulders. I joined a band. I started smoking weed and drinking and started to break all the rules. Now, the band immediately broke up, but I learned that the guys that were booking our band out were making way more money than we were. And I learned that there was this job in New York City called a nightclub promoter. And if you could fill up clubs with beautiful people, you could get paid lots of money to do that. And people would even pay $500 to drink a bottle of vodka that cost $20. So for the next 10 years, this became my life, walking completely away from any sort of, you know, traditional conservative background. And at 28 years old, after a decade in the business, this was a snapshot of my life, getting paid $2,000 a month just to drink Bacardi in public. And another $2,000 a month just to drink Budweiser in public. So I thought I was the man. I choose this photo because it shows what an idiot I was. I am holding out the Rolex watch so that the photographer notices that I have an expensive watch. Now, it might have looked glamorous to my friends on the outside, but it wasn't very glamorous. This is a snapshot of me around 5 or 6 in the morning. And it was a very dark, dark life. And I, on a trip to South America, finally came to my senses and realized that I was the most spiritually, emotionally, morally bankrupt person that I knew, and I needed to make a change. Now, I was with all the right people. I was in Punta del Este, and, you know, I had everything I thought I wanted, the BMW, the beautiful dog, the beautiful girlfriend that was on billboards, the watch, the grand piano, and I was miserable. So I actually started rediscovering my faith, I think, in a different way as an adult. You know, it wasn't shoved down my throat anymore. And I decided that I would try to live it out with integrity and leave everything behind and go serve the poor. Now, I thought this would be easy, so I started applying to all these humanitarian organizations. But to my surprise, I am denied by every organization I tried to volunteer for. They said, you know, what is a nightclub promoter? Like, how would you be useful to our mission in Uganda or our mission in Sudan? Finally, and thankfully for me, later that year in the fall of 2004, an organization called Mercy Ship said, if you pay us $500 a month, you can volunteer. So I thought, all right, here's my credit card. And I said, where are you guys going? And they said, well, we're going to a country called Liberia. Now, at the time, I thought Africa was a single country. Didn't realize that Liberia was one of many. And said, sure, I'm in. What do I have to do? And I'd applied to be their volunteer photographer and take pictures of everything that happened on this humanitarian mission. So I learned that I was going to be joining a hospital ship, and this became my new home for the next year. Big apartment in New York, traded for a couple hundred square feet around the waterline with two strange roommates that worked in the engine room and a bunch of cockroaches. And I started feeling sorry for myself immediately until I left the ship and saw how people were living in Liberia. And after the 14-year Civil War, Charles Taylor decimated this place. There was no electricity, there was no running water, there was no sewage, there was no mail. People were living in bombed-out apartment buildings, in houses, in ruins. I learned that if you got sick in Liberia, you were in real trouble. And what our organization was doing was bringing doctors to people who needed access to medical care. So before the ship sailed in, an advance team would put up these posters everywhere. And they'd say, if you've got a huge tumor, if you've got a piece missing from your face, flesh-eating disease, if you've got a cleft lip or a cleft palate, turn up, and maybe our doctors can help you for free. So I was so excited about this. You know, my third day there, I grabbed my camera. We're rolling up to the stadium at 5:30 in the morning to see who turned up, who we could help. And I knew we had 1,500 surgery slots. 7,000 people came. And I remember taking this picture through tears as I knew 5,000 people were going to be turned away, and some of them had walked a month. In Liberia, there was one doctor for every 50,000 people in the country. In our world, there's one for about 200. First kid in line shocked me. It's this boy, Alfred, and he was 14, and he had a benign tumor, and he was suffocating to death on his own face. And I remember meeting him and just losing it. I just started weeping. I ran in the corner of the stadium saying, you know, I want to go back home. I don't think I can handle this. And the chief medical officer came up to me and said, you know, look, kid, you signed up to do this. This is what our organization has done for 25 years. Toughen up. You've got 2 days, and you're going to meet 150, 200 people, just like Alfred, with conditions this severe. So I pulled it together. And then he invited me into Alfred's surgery a couple days later, and I saw what was happening on the ship and what I had signed up for. In a few hours surgery, volunteer doctors took out the tumor, and then they said, why don't you take Alfred home with his new face? Why don't you take him back to his village? And it was an incredible, incredible moment, watching Alfred received back in, hundreds of people dancing and celebrating and watching him heal. And this is what life was like. I would wake up and I'd meet a woman named Marceline and learn that for 10 years she'd had a towel in her hand because when she walked out of her hut, people would throw rocks at her. They thought she was cursed. What she needed was a 45-minute surgery that she just couldn't afford and got a brand new face back. So the first year, I took about 50,000 photos. I met some of the most incredible people. I signed up for another year. And on that second tour, I started learning what was making some of the people sick. It was dirty water. Now, thankfully for me, Mercy Ships had given a little bit of money to a guy off to the side, and he was working in the villages helping people get clean water. So because I had to photograph everything, I jumped in Land Rovers with him and said, show me what you're doing. And he showed me the sources that people were drinking from, and they were ponds and swamps and rivers. I remember saying to him, like, hey, you know, no wonder things are growing on people's faces. I wouldn't step in that water. I wouldn't let my dog drink that water. And entire communities, it was all that they had. So what he would do is he would work with the locals. He would train them how to tap into the clean groundwater that was often 10 meters, 15 meters beneath the swamp. And then he would take me back a couple months later, and I could drink the clean water in the village. And while we were doing these impactful surgeries and saving lives, this guy off to the side was touching thousands of people for a fraction of the cost. And that left a deep impression on me. I came back to New York City at 30. I was completely changed. I'd given up every vice I had when I'd walked up the gangway of the ship. I wanted everything in my life to look completely different. And I knew that I was going to serve for the rest of my life. I just didn't know what I was going to do. I wanted to make the biggest impact I could. I had to make up for lost time, the 10 years that I'd wasted. I'd seen a lot of problems when I was there, but I kept coming back to the swamp. No one, no man, no woman, no child should ever have to drink green water with bugs, with algae, with disease in it. And there the idea for Charity Water was born. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the water crisis, some of the things that I learned. 800 million people right now don't have clean water to drink. And I bet every single person in this room has never had to drink dirty water. You've just never had to do it. You haven't had to drink water from a swamp or a pond or a river. 800 million people do every single day. Now, if you were to come with me, this is what you would see. You would see people fighting with algae to get drinking water. You would see open wells being shared with people, with cows, in the same sources. You would learn that 80% of disease in the world, up to 80%, so says the World Health Organization, is directly caused by bad water and a lack of toilets. Kills more people than all the wars in the world. Met this child in Athenai, Kenya, and I remember watching in horror as she drank from a river. It was the Molo River, and she would drink, and then she would just vomit all over her shirt. She would drink again, she would throw up. And we took the water from her. We promised to help the village. But I took this back through customs, and I gave it to a lab in New York City, and I said, show me what is in this water. What is making her so sick? They put it under a microscope, and they made us a video. And they said, you know, we're not sure what all those things are, but it's alive. Nobody should have to drink water like this. We gave them New York City tap water. We got a video with nothing moving. Learned that leeches were a huge problem. Again, you know, in my entire life, I'd never imagined associating a leech with drinking water, but community after community would show us the leeches. And they'd say, the big ones are never a problem, but sometimes the little ones, they get through our filtration, they get through the cloth that we filter the water through. They grow up inside, and their favorite spot is the back of the throat. You know, you hear this the first few times, and you're like, oh, they're making this up. You hear it 30, 40, 50, 60 times, and you realize it's a huge problem. Two ways common to get leeches off of the back of someone's throat. One is to use a stick and to scrape it. And the second is to drink diesel fuel. Enough to kill the leech, but not enough to kill the person. Learned that 40 billion hours were wasted every year fetching water in Africa alone. This is actually more than the entire workforce of France, the entire global economy. Wasted back and forth, fetching water that's not even clean. Imagine what people could do if that time was given back to them. And it's backbreaking work, and it kills you to see kids breaking their backs carrying 40 pounds of water, hours a day. 2 weeks ago, I was in Kenya. I was in eastern Kenya near the Somalia border. And I saw people digging in the sand for water. In sandy riverbeds, you know, I put my mom in that hole. I can't even imagine it. The community here told us that this was the better source of drinking water, and it was available 25% of the year. The other source, we walked with them an hour or two, was the Tana River, and it was this water. And we heard at every village we went to along this river that the biggest problem for the communities are crocodiles. When they fetch water, they're afraid of crocodiles killing them and their children. Two kids were killed in this village in the last 12 months. And off to the side, the left of the photo, there was a woman lobbing dirt into the river to try to scare the crocodiles away. Men were rolling up their pant legs, showing us the attacks, showing us the scars they had. So one story I heard this year that illustrates just how urgent this problem really is. There's a woman I was in northwestern Ethiopia in a crappy like $4 or $5 a night hotel room, and I was with some friends and some donors. And we have a huge commitment in Ethiopia. The hotel owner comes up to me and he's like, "You're the Charity Water people, yeah. We know about your work." He said, "Let me tell you a story of a woman in my village that lived before you started. Her name was Leta Koros. I actually don't have a photo, but I use this to illustrate the clay pot." He said, "She didn't have the jerry can. She had a clay pot that weighed 20 pounds, and then another 30 when full." He said, "She used to walk 8 hours a day to fetch water, 3 hours out, 5 hours back." And he said, "One day she came back into the village and she'd just been gone 8 hours. He said, she slipped and she fell. And the clay pot broke and all the water spilled out. And he said, she took the rope and she hung herself from a tree in the middle of the village." And he looked at our group and he said, "The work you're doing is important." And he walked off. The irony is, she lives right in a village where we're working at the moment, 5 years too late. So it's a problem. The good news is, it's completely solvable. So we know how to bring clean drinking water right now to every single person on Earth. And if you're solution agnostic and you don't try to jam one solution down any community's throat, you can solve the problem. Sometimes through hand dug wells, like in Liberia. Sometimes you can drill. A couple weeks ago, it was a well that was 300 meters deep. Sometimes you can harvest the rain, you can catch mountain springs and use gravity to take them down to villages. Sometimes you can clean water, sand filters, both at the community level, at the household level. For $65 in Cambodia, you can give a family clean water. You can take water like this, you can pour it through a $65 filter, sand, gravel, rock, and get water like this out that you or I could drink, and I did. For about $5,000, you can hand dig a well. Community contributes all the labor. It's just months of work, and water starts coming in. You dewater, you keep going deeper so the well lasts 12 months a year. Make these concrete culverts so that they don't collapse. For a little more, you can drill. You bring in $1 million drilling rig, 8 skilled drillers. And the deeper you go, the more water you get. You're tapping into massive underground lakes, massive aquifers underneath these villages, many of them which have never had clean water. And when you can bring water into communities, it truly transforms them. It changes everything. Kids stop dying of disease. They're healthier. They spend more time in school. They don't have to walk 3 or 4 hours a day. They're not sick 3 times, 4 times a month. The women will tell us time and time again that they use this extra reclaimed time and they start small businesses. They'll sell peanuts, they'll sell rice, they'll sell milk at the market, earning an extra $1 a day. Some of the women tell us they use the time and they're just better moms. They spend more time with their families. And what I loved about it was provable. Right? You could know that you'd made a difference. You could know that you had truly impacted the life of a family, of a community, of a region. There was either clean water or there wasn't. You could taste it, you could test it, you could photograph it. The United Nations came out with a powerful 88-page report recently that said every dollar you invest in water and sanitation gives you a 12 times return to the local economy. Water makes people healthier, but it really makes them wealthier. An average of 12 times as much. Helen's story illustrates an unintended positive consequence of clean water, something we'd never thought of before. She was in a village that had gotten a charity water project, and our head of programs was going in. It was after a long day in northern Uganda. And without all the fanfare, without the amazing celebrations that typically accompany the visit, she just wanted to sneak into the village and see it being used, check up on the construction, check the water. Helen had somehow gotten word that we were coming, And that didn't happen. For a while, and she finally, when it settled down, she got to talk with Helen. She said, Helen, what was your life like before clean water came to your village? And Helen said, well, I used to have to walk far. She said, all I could carry was 2 jerry cans a day. And she said, I had a husband and 2 kids. And I had to make choices every single day. What would I do with the water? Would I cook? Would I clean? Would I garden? Would I wash my husband's clothes? Would I wash the kids' school uniforms? She said, if they went to school with dirty uniforms, they were sent home. And she said, I always put myself last. She said, now that there is clean water in my village, I can take 3 times as much water. And she said to Becky, she said, now I am beautiful. And Becky said, what do you mean? She said, now I feel beautiful. There's enough water for me to wash my face and my clothes. We realized that water not only made people healthier, it made them richer, it could restore dignity. It could make a woman like Helen feel beautiful. So what was I going to do about it? I had blown 10 years living selfishly, drinking for a living, spent 2 years taking pictures in Africa, learning a little bit. I was actually $30,000 in debt because I'd given Mercy Ships all my money. It wasn't a great time to start a charity. But I thought, I'm going to do it anyway. See if before I die, I could be a part of ending the water crisis and seeing a day where every single person had clean water to drink. And I also wanted to reinvent giving, reinvent charity. All my friends that I were talking to, A, they didn't even know there was a water crisis. They'd always had clean water. And B, they were distrustful of charities. They didn't believe in charities. They weren't giving. I heard this phrase, the black hole, time and time again. You know, I give money to that organization, it just disappears in a black hole. Charities are inefficient and bureaucratic and not transparent. And it was all of this negative spin. And I thought, what doesn't have to be? What if we created a new model? What if we tried to get in the way of some of those objections and bring people back to the table of giving? So I had 3 ideas on how we could do that. One was, let's just figure out a way to use 100% of the public's money directly on projects. So never use any of it for our staff or our office or our administration or our flights. 2 separate bank accounts and a promise that 100% of the money would always go to help the people that needed it. And people said, how will you do that? I wasn't really sure at the time, but I had $100 each and I opened up these accounts and said, you know, we're not only going to give away 100%, we're going to be so crazy about this that we're going to pay back the credit card transaction fees. So if someone gave us $1,000 and we got $960 of that, we would separately raise $40, we would send all $1,000 to the field. And I thought we could find entrepreneurs, visionary donors and investors who would want to support the staff, who would want to build the organization. And if we were accountable, if we treated them like shareholders, like investors, if we were able to leverage their money, maybe we could make this model work. The second thing was just prove where the money went. And this was so simple to me. Use technology to do it. I walked into an electronics store, and you could buy a handheld GPS device for $99. I said, well, that's great. We're going to be building water projects around the world. We should prove every single one. We should know where they are. And we should show the donors where they are. So we said, we will never invest unless we could be guaranteed proof, and then we'll make all of that public on Google Earth, on Google Maps from day one, so people can actually see where the money is going and who it's helping. And the third thing I wanted to do was a little softer, but I wanted to build a brand. Charities were so bad at marketing. Their websites were as bad as insurance companies. It was like a poverty mentality in the sector, and I wasn't sure if people just didn't have good taste or I don't know, but they just look so bad. There wasn't a single aspirational, amazing charity brand that I wanted to be associated with. But there were other brands like Apple, like Nike, that I did want to be associated with. And I thought, maybe we could build an epic brand and solve a problem this big. So the only thing I knew how to do 6 years ago was go back to the clubs and throw a party. Invited 700 friends, I gave them open bar, I charged them $20 to the door, and then we took the $15,000 we raised immediately to a refugee camp in northern Uganda. We wish we could have done more, but we built three wells, we fixed three wells, and we sent those photos and GPS back to the 700 people that attended the party. And we realized there was an incredible power. If you could close the loop, if you could tell someone what you did with $20. We started product collaborations. We went to our friends at Tom's Shoes, at Jawbone. We made iPad cases. We made playing cards to raise awareness and raise money. We came up with ad campaigns and we said, you know, we don't always need to be serious all the time. We could come up with different ways to just get people to think about water. Most of the time we were serious and we tried to bring these mind-numbing statistics to life. Who can imagine 4,500 kids? But maybe death in a baby bottle would resonate for a parent or a brother or a sister. We got donated media on buses, on taxis, and magazines. We partnered with brands like Saks Fifth Avenue, who shot their catalogs in water, gave up the windows of their stores, both in New York City and around the country, to raise awareness. They got their employees involved. They got vendors involved. Raised $700,000 as a company. A group called McAllen came to us and they said, you know, there's a lot of water in Scotland, there's a lot of water in whiskey, what can we do to help? And they got the idea to take their oldest whiskey, a 64-year-old McAllen, on a world tour and just to taste it. You had to sponsor a water project, $5,000. We thought they were crazy. Who would pay $5,000 for 10 centiliters? Until they sent us a $605,000 check from a single bottle. Somebody paid $62,500 in Taipei. We love social media. It was a simple story we were telling. People need water. Here are the solutions. We'll prove them. We were the first charity to reach 1 million followers on Twitter. We loved social media. We were visual communicators. We put out communicators. We put out a photo of the day on Facebook, on Twitter, on Instagram. We tried to reinvent the gala. We hated these boring charity dinners that we got invited to, and we tried to create a celebration for 2,500 people where they could come together, and we created interactive experiences where people would carry water, and every time they did, businesses would sponsor water projects. Just by carrying the water at the gala, you'd earn $500 to help people get clean water. We got to open up the NASDAQ a couple times, close the New York Stock Exchange, just looking for creative ways to get our story out there. But then we stumbled upon the big idea, which started to scale. On our one-year anniversary, you know, I was thinking about doing another birthday party in a club, and it just didn't scale, you know. Guess I could charge a little more. I guess I could invite more people. But I thought, what if I skipped the party and I asked everyone I knew to donate my age, 32, in dollars? I thought, you know, I have everything I need. 800 million people don't even have clean water. And all my friends have $32 that they could give, especially if 100% went to help and they could see where it went. To my surprise, I raised $59,000. And then a 7-year-old kid in Texas starts knocking on doors and he's asking for his age in dollars. $777,777. He raises $22,000. And we said, wow, this is a big idea. You know, everybody in the world could care about clean water. Everybody in the world has a birthday every year. And we have enough stuff. What if we could turn the birthday into a giving moment, into an unselfish day, our birthdays, so people could live longer and have birthdays? It started to take off throughout the tech community, through Hollywood. Justin Bieber tweeted 3 times, raised $47,000. Daniel Ek of Spotify blew his goal away. Jack Dorsey gave up 3 birthdays, raising almost $200,000. Will and Jada Smith gave up birthdays, asked their fans to give up birthdays. Wound up in a contest raising actually almost $1 million, came with us to Ethiopia to see in person what they had done. Most of the money, though, was not raised by celebrities or tech entrepreneurs, just raised by everyday people. People like Maggie Moran, a 16-year-old kid who gave up her party, didn't accept gifts, and raised enough to give a community clean water. And then quickly, Nona Ween gave up her 89th birthday. I love her story. She didn't even raise $89. but she wrote a beautiful mission statement. She got it. She is double the life expectancy of so many of the countries where we work. And she wanted other people to be able to live to 89. It grew beyond birthdays. People started climbing mountains. They started skydiving for charity water, giving up weddings, sending in $10,000 checks saying, we're not having a wedding. We want to build water projects instead. We've had people sail across the Atlantic Ocean. We've had 4 or 5 people now walk across America. And we had a 9-year-old girl eat rice and beans for a month. We made a short video just to highlight some of the amazing things our fundraisers have done.
1 billion people do not have clean water. The water is not good for the kids. It's so dangerous.
I was eating rice and beans for 25 days to raise money for my first well.
Are you all ready? Are you ready? Get set. Are you ready? Get set. Are you ready? Are you all ready? Are you ready? Get set. Are you ready? Get set. Let's go. Is the cat put out? Is he young enough? We don't want to come home to a fire. Have you trimmed your beard? Are you stand or shine? Do you look like a hipster messiah? Have you got your keys? Have you got ID? Did you bring a comb for Gary? Have you had a think and a warm-up drink? No, 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 no.
Take 156. This is my second time shooting for charity water.
So it took off, and fundraisers around the world started giving everything they had. They came up with the most creative ideas, and it just started growing larger. Now, this is an awkward transition, but I can't talk about our fundraisers without talking about Rachel. And some of you may have even heard about this story. One of our fundraisers was a 9-year-old girl from Seattle, and she gave up her birthday, and she said, I want to raise $300. I want to help 15 people get clean water. She wound up raising $220. She fell a little short. And she told her mom, I'm so sorry. I'm going to do better next year. Right after her birthday, Rachel was killed in a horrible car crash. She went to a local church in Seattle, and the pastor started spreading the word around the church of her campaign and encouraging people to donate $9. On her campaign page. And quickly, Rachel had raised $100,000. And then it spread to the Seattle community, and she'd raised $300,000. And then it started spreading around the world, and people in Africa started donating. People in Asia, people in Europe, people in the South Pacific heard about a 9-year-old girl who, instead of gifts, wanted 15 kids to have clean water. I met her mom for the first time after it happened, and I said, you should spend the 1-year anniversary of Rachel's death with me in Ethiopia, and you should meet some of the people that your daughter has helped. And she said, I'd love to come. And that trip happened a few months ago. We took her pastor, her mom, her grandparents on the 1-year anniversary, and I want to share that short video that we think honors her legacy. Thank you.
6 in the morning, and we're about to go see some of Rachel's wells.
I am Richard. I am Rachel's grandfather. I really wish Rachel could be here today, because first of all, Rachel would think that this is probably the neatest thing she'd ever seen in her entire life.
Our community, our church, where we are from, we greatly love Rachel and continue to love her family. And I'm overwhelmed with how greatly you have honored her memory. So please receive my most deepest and heartfelt thanks. You've done us a great honor today, so thank you.
Yeah.
Rachel developed such a big heart from such a young age that she understood and felt the pain of others on the other side of the world. To give up her birthday present so that other children can improve their lives is the most beautiful gift a person can give.
What Rachel and all of the amazing fundraisers taught us was that what had started out as our story, this disruptive story of a charity trying to break the rules and solve a problem, it didn't belong to us anymore. It was their story. It was the story of Max. It was the story of Daniel, of Jill, of Riley, of Rachel. And if we could give it away, if we could actually be intentional of taking a back seat, giving people simple tools, maybe we could solve this problem. It also let us know there was a deep, deep sense of responsibility to be good stewards of this. And we wanted Rachel's family, we wanted the donors around the world to see what they'd done and use technology to do it. So we created a product, Dollars to Projects, that tied every single dollar with integrity through to the community it served. So Maggie gave up her 16th, she could see exactly where that money went. She could see that she helped 545 people in the village of Mayawilel and that it cost $45.96. She could see a sign or a plaque with her name on it. She can see where it is on Google Earth. And then all of our donors get to see exactly where their donation went. Because 100% of the money is never touched, this is possible. We crowdsourced the world's first drilling rig last year, $1.2 million rig, fleet, compressors, and 13,000 people gave. We said, well, you know, this isn't a water project, but what if we connected the 13,000 people to the rig by mounting a GPS unit on it? What if we tracked the thing in real time, and what if we gave it a Twitter account? And every time it drilled a well, it tweeted. It's funny, we actually tried to engage the Mars Curiosity rover in a dialogue, and she totally blew us off. Wouldn't respond. We just gave up after a while. She said, you're drilling in Mars for water. We're drilling in Ethiopia. Anyway, it was powerful for someone to give $10 and be able to connect to a rig to see it for the next 15 years. And what I'm really excited to announce today, we thought it was disruptive when we could know where the projects are, but we said to ourselves, we need to know how they're working over time. And we thought, what if we could develop remote sensors that went in all of these different solutions that might be able to give us data in real time that we might be able to share with a 16-year-old girl like Maggie for years to come? So we started coming up with this concept and looking into the sensors, and we said, well, you know, if we found out that a project wasn't working, we would need to be able to act on that. We started training local technicians, typically women in these countries. We had this goal, this vision of doing 4,000 sensors as a pilot in four countries. And I'm glad to announce today, 3 hours before the official announcement in San Francisco, that the project was completely funded, and we received a $5 million grant from the Global Impact Awards from Google that will allow us to develop and put these out in the field. And we think continue transparency and accountability in the sector. The first 6 years, we got a lot done, and we've now raised $77 million from a cold start, from 350,000 generous donors all around the world. Small donations making this possible. More importantly, we've turned it into clean water for almost 3 million people. We've been growing it like a startup. 90% growth for the first 5 years. Charitable donations in America have not looked like this. They've been net negative. They've been declining. But we don't think of ourselves as a traditional charity. We've funded almost 7,000 projects in 20 countries. Right now, over 1,000 locals are working on charity water projects. A team of 500 in Ethiopia alone. Masons, technicians, hydrologists, drivers, engineers. Funding a bunch of different solutions, bringing clean water to people. Last year, we gave 700,000 people clean water. That's one person every 42 seconds. And we want to start taking back these statistics. Instead of talking about people dying, talking about people actually getting clean water, talking about the problem being solved. As we look ahead, we said, we think we've proved a little bit of the model. Let's think really big. Let's go after 100 million people in the next 10 years. Maybe we can even get there sooner. And then let's keep going until the entire problem is solved. To do this, we're going to have to raise $3 billion, $30 a person. It's a huge number. We're going to have to raise another 10%, $300 million, to run the organization, to be good stewards of this, to develop new technology, to monitor the projects. But we think we live in an age where this is possible. If there was ever a time in history, it's now. Now more than even a week ago or a month ago. So I'll ask you guys, maybe you're willing to make this your story. Maybe you're willing to help. There are three simple ways that you can get involved. Coming over to Europe is new for us. Maybe you could get your company involved. Maybe you yourself would give up Christmas presents, give up gifts, and support a water project, knowing that 100% of the money goes. And everybody in this room could give up your birthday. I've done five now. I've given up my birthday for the rest of my life. I just don't need gifts. Maybe you say, instead of a party, instead of gifts, I'm going to ask for my age in euros or pounds or dollars. If you're interested in doing that, you can go to charitywater.org /birthdays. You can pledge it and we'll send you a reminder 3 weeks before it happens. We believe in a world where every single person has clean and safe water to drink, and we will continue fighting until that happens. Thank you guys so much for your time.
Scott, that's amazing. It's incredible what you're doing. It's true entrepreneurship for nonprofit. It's amazing. I would like to ask you, I know you're not comfortable with this, but Scott is going back to New York, so I'd like to ask you a very simple thing. Just give your business card to one of our hostesses on the side so that you know you can keep in touch with Scott and Charlie Water. Give your birthday. I actually feel really bad because I met you now about a year ago. I donated, but I didn't give my birthday, which is probably because it's in July, so I forgot, but I will next give my one. Birthday, and I'm going to also donate a well today myself.
Oh, thanks, Louis.
Because it's so simple. It's $5,000, right? And $5,000 for a well to save a village of water is just incredible. But I'd like you to participate and at least give your birthday, give a business card. Our hostesses are there to help. And Scott, thanks so much. I know you're so busy saving the world, taking the time to come here, share your story. Thank you very much, Scott.